registering voters. One of the biggest talking points, politically speaking, in this country for the last several months now has been the Rafale deal, with the Congress again and again and again coming up with allegations of corruption, of favouritism against the BJP government. And every single time the BJP government has hit back saying, well, you don't know the details, we can't give you a lot of details, but this is no Augusta Westland, this is no Beauforce. Now, I don't want to talk politics tonight, but what I do want to focus on is the legal aspects. This deal and questions about this deal did land up in the Supreme Court. You will all remember, just a few weeks ago, the Supreme Court dismissed the petition that sought an investigation into this deal to see if proper procedure was followed, if there was any wrongdoing. The Supreme Court said, we don't see any merit, we don't see a need for interference, we are satisfied with the answers that have been given to us by the government. The government had made its submission about sensitive details regarding the deal, especially the pricing, in a sealed envelope meant only for the judges and nobody else. The judges read that, they wrote their order and dismissed the plea. Interestingly, it is only after that that many people pointed out to the fact, including the head of the Parliamentary Committee, the PAC, the Public Accounts Committee, that as per the Supreme Court order, CAG had, the Comptroller Auditor General, had actually scrutinised this deal, made a report as an auditor, and sent it to even the PAC. The PAC members and its chairman came out to say, we never got this report. So what is the Supreme Court talking about? Did the government lie to the Supreme Court? The government then came out with its own affidavit that said that the facts that were given to the Supreme Court were perhaps misunderstood, that we only quoted the procedure, that the Comptroller and Auditor General is actually still looking at the deal, details of the deal. They haven't yet sent it to the PAC, so the Public Accounts Committee, the Parliamentary Committee, doesn't really have the details. What is there is only a redacted portion of the deal. Now, does that mean that the Supreme Court will have to modify its order? Or does it mean the Supreme Court may need to review its order? Prashant Bhushan, Arun Shori and Yashwant Sinha believe that this is grounds for a review of the verdict into Rafale. The government believes if the Supreme Court wants, they can modify their order. So we are going to dwell into these legal aspects of what the Supreme Court verdict spoke about, and is there a need to review that verdict? Here's a short report.
An objection to this new
price.
The country today witnessed fireworks in the parliament over the Rafale deal, and even some paper planes flying around. The opposition and the government once again locking horns.
Price of the aircraft under the new deal went from 526 crores to 1600 crores.
The Congress party, which has in the past been headed by great legends, is today headed by a gentleman who doesn't even have a basic understanding of what a combat aircraft is.
We demand a JPC in this matter.
Sab pe Supreme Court ka faisla aa gaya, to is faisle ke virudh jana, kaun si parliamentary committee is faisle ke virudh apni report de sakti hai?
If it makes you happy.
Congress wants a joint parliamentary committee on Rafale, but the government is adamant it isn't needed. Allegations of a scandalous leaked audio tape of former defence minister are added to the controversy.
राफेल घोटाले में अब गोवा की भाजपा सरकार के मंत्री ने सनसनीखेज और चौंकाने वाला खुलासा किया है और भ्रष्टाचार की सारी परतें उजागर कर दी हैं। कुछ दिन पूर्व हुई इस हंगामेदार बैठक में गहमा गहमी के बीच जिस प्रकार से गंभीर रूप से अस्वस्थ होने के बावजूद गोवा के मुख्यमंत्री के पद पर पदेन रहे श्री मनोहर पारिकर ने कहा कि उनका कोई कुछ नहीं कर सकता, क्योंकि राफेल की सारी फाइलें उनके पास हैं, उनके बेडरूम में, उनके फ्लैट के अंदर मौजूद हैं।
Meanwhile, the battle in the courtrooms is expected to begin again. Former union ministers Yashwant Sinha and Arun Shori, along with advocate Prashant Bhushan, approached the Supreme Court seeking review of its December 14 judgment, which dismissed all PILs alleging irregularities in the procurement of 36 Rafale jets.
What is this procedure which they say they are saying is misinterpreted? They have supplied false information to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court could not have invented a PSC report. They could not have invented a CAG report. So these people supplied false information and now they are caught. The material placed before us shows that the government has not disclosed pricing details other than the basic price of the aircraft even to the parliament. Okay? The pricing details have, however, been shared with the Comptroller and Auditor General, and the report of the CAG has been examined by the Public Accounts Committee. Only a redacted portion of the report has been placed before Parliament, was placed before the Parliament, and is in public domain. There are four falsehoods in that two-sentence paragraph. Four falsehoods.
In its affidavit, the government said that the top court had misinterpreted its earlier affidavit, clarifying that in its report to the CAG, the centre had only cited the procedure. So tonight we ask, should there be a review on Rafale judgment by the top court? Let's debate.
Before we begin the debate, we straight away go across to Mr. Prashant Bhushan, who's joining us right now on The Last Word. Good evening and thank you for joining us, Mr. Bhushan. You filed a plea in Supreme Court seeking a review of its verdict on the Rafale petition. On what grounds, sir, are you seeking this review?
Because, you see, the judgment is so patently absurd. It firstly doesn't deal with our prayer, which was seeking a court-monitored CBI investigation. It instead proceeds on the basis as if we are seeking cancellation of the contract. Secondly, it contains several grotesque errors of fact, which have come about because of the court adopting a totally irregular procedure of taking sealed covers from the government, which were not even on affidavit, which were unsigned notes, and then taking cognizance of those, treating those facts to be the truth, which is again totally something completely unknown to judicial procedure, that you just take a slip of paper, which is not even signed, nobody takes responsibility for it, you take that as the gospel truth, you regurgitate it in your judgment as if it's the gospel truth, and it turns out, I mean, so many facts have turned out to be totally false. The fact about the CAG report, which is non-existent, that it was given to the PSE, PSE further looked at it and placed it before Parliament, that it has been put up in public domain, everything is false. Secondly, they say that this Dassault was already in negotiation with the parent company of Anil Ambani. That company is totally different. How can the court say that this is the parent company of Anil Ambani? Thirdly, they say that the Air Force officers also came and told the court about the process, about the process by which the deal was gone through, as well as about the price, etc. Again, totally false. Nothing of the kind happened, nothing of the kind was asked of these Air Force officers, etc. And then they don't even deal with our conclusive refutations of the claims of the government made in these unsigned notes given in sealed cover, etc. We had conclusively refuted many of the things which the court has cited in their judgment on affidavit with documentary evidence. The court does not even take those into consideration and passes a judgment merely on the basis of these claims made in an unsigned sealed cover. It's completely unheard of.
the government calls it misinterpretation of facts that it had submitted and goes into great details of is versus has been and how the words have really been used. Government just says that if the Supreme Court wants, it can modify its order. Why isn't a modification enough, Mr. Bhushan? Why are you seeking a complete review?
No, this is not a typographical or a clerical error, as the government is saying in its application. This is clearly an error of not one, but at least four errors of fact here. And if the court was misinformed or misunderstood what the government was saying, and if the court understood that this CAG report was indeed there, it has been given to the PSC, PSC has placed it before Parliament, Parliament has put it in public domain, then we had said on affidavit that 56 senior IAS officers, IAS and IPS officers and former election commissioners and CAG officers, etc., have said that the CAG is not even going into this deal and it should go into this deal. How is it that it escaped the court's notice to even ask the government, ki, where is the CAG report? It should have at least asked for the CAG report. How can the court deal with such a serious matter in such a cavalier fashion?
Finance Minister Arun Jaitley spoke in Lok Sabha today, and while responding to the Congress party's charge, he said that for all crucial contentious issues like pricing, the Supreme Court has already given its verdict and said that it is satisfied. So where is the debate now? What do you have to say to that interpretation of the verdict?
Court was not satisfied. No, that's a totally wrong interpretation. Court was not satisfied. The court said that the government has claimed this and it is not for the court to go into pricing. That's all. When in fact, you see, government had claimed something which we had refuted in our petition, in our rejoinder affidavit, conclusively. And yet this claims, the bald claims of the government are just swallowed.
Mr. Bhushan, just lastly, one more question. Justice Chelameshwar in a recent interview said that he isn't in favour of this practice of submitting information in a sealed envelope to the courtrooms and wasn't really speaking specifically about Rafale deal, but that was his view. Would you agree that we should do away with this practice?
Yes, totally. Because you see, this whole business of taking things in a sealed cover and relying on those things is a gross violation of the principles of natural justice. How can you rely on something which is not even shown to the petitioners and giving them an opportunity to refute that? Any kind of falsity can be stated in a sealed cover. How will the court know that this is false? And this is exactly what has happened in this case. And in this case, the sealed cover was not even on affidavit. It's an unsigned note. Nobody has taken responsibility for it.
Well, thank you, Mr. Bhushan, for joining us. We, of course, will closely track what happens to your appeal in the top court. But thank you for speaking to the viewers of Mirror Now. Let's say good evening to the rest of our panel. Aditya Shankar, spokesperson for the BJP. Mohammed Khan, spokesperson for the Congress party. I also have with me Geeta Luthra, senior advocate of Supreme Court. Kailash Vasudev, also a senior advocate with the Supreme Court. And Biswajit Bhattacharya, former additional solicitor general. And Mr. Bhattacharya, let's begin with you. Where do you stand on this debate, legally speaking? Do you see enough grounds for a review, or just a mere modification of the order based on what the government affidavit says will be enough?
You see, from facts which have appeared in the public domain through the press, it is quite evident and obvious that the Supreme Court was misled. And if Supreme Court has been misled, bona fide, not bona fide, less than bona fide, I am not going into it, then I think this entire judgment of 14th of December needs at least a barest minimum correction. That could have been done by the Supreme Court, I mean, suo motu. This can be done by means of an application which the Government of India has moved, ostensibly seeking an error of what mistakes. This can also be considered by the review petition which the petitioners have filed. But the fact of the matter is that today, according to me, Supreme Court is the aggrieved party, should be the aggrieved party. Because the facts placed before the Supreme Court, as understood by the Supreme Court, two very outstanding honorable judges of the highest court in the country, it is preposterous on the part of anyone to suggest that whatever material has been pressed, non-silt cover, is a different issue altogether. According to the wisdom and understanding of the three highest judges of the country, I think they have been misled, and judges could have also suo motu made any correction order with, like the CAG report is not even in the public domain. The Public Accounts Committee had no opportunity to go through a non-existent report. The pricing was the entire issue. Alleged ostensible inflated price. Under Article 149 of the Constitution of India, it is the only constitutional check is that of a CAG.
Yes.
So it could have been stated that this petition is premature at this stage. Let CAG look into it. But instead of that, if the impression has been created, rightly or wrongly, I don't want to go into it, because whatever I'm speaking only by means of the reports which have appeared in the press in the public domain.
Yes.
I think there is no option but to correct whatever factual inaccuracies have been crept in. And if Supreme Court in its own wisdom comes to the conclusion that somebody somewhere was trying to take Supreme Court for a ride, then it's high time Supreme Court fixes some kind of accountability.
Right.
Well, so that howsoever high you may be, whoever may be the sort of litigant, whether it is the poorest man in the country, whether it is the richest man in the country, whether it is the Government of India, the yardstick ought to be the same.
Yes.
If you try to mislead the court and then try to impute that this is a typographical error, I think one has to draw the Lakshman Rekha. The rule of law in our country has to reign supreme.
Right. Okay,
and
point
the
taken.
The majesty and sanctity of the Supreme Court proceedings must not be allowed to be compromised.
I absolutely agree with you. And so this is what is part of the government affidavit says, which in itself is an admission that something went wrong between what the government wrote and gave the Supreme Court and what came out in the verdict. And the affidavit says, the second part of the sentence in regard to PAC is to the effect that the report of the CAG is examined by the PAC, Public Accounts Committee. However, in the judgment, the reference to the word is has been replaced with the words has been. And the sentence in the judgment then reads, the reports of CAG has been examined by the Public Accounts Committee. Mr. Kailash Vasudev, is this as simple as saying, oh, is and has been got mixed up, or maybe you didn't understand what we were writing in our affidavit, so you can just modify that bit, correct that bit, and that would be the end of this conversation? Or does this then say that if you are not too sure of what happened, if the CAG hasn't yet given a report, if the Public Accounts Committee hasn't yet looked at the details of the deal, then perhaps the Supreme Court order needs to be completely re-looked at?
What the government is seeking right now is a complete re-look at the order. Based on their contention that this was not mentioned in the note, which they had filed in a sealed cover. The views taken are that the sealed cover is not a document which can be taken into evidence because it is not supported by an affidavit. We must understand that in many proceedings in courts, and very often, the courts ask for sealed covers in which the documents are presented to the court for verification. It is not necessary that those documents come with a sealed, in the sealed cover, come with an affidavit. Here is a situation which has massive fallouts for everybody, including the security of our country, as to what exactly transpired in the court, because what has been stated there also includes issues which deal with pricing, because the court says that they're satisfied with the pricing aspect. So you see, if the government is seeking to have a clarification or a relook at the situation, moving an application for modification happens in the courts, but you see, under the Civil Procedure Code, a normal practice, you apply to the court for correction of a typographical mistake.
Yes.
This is where you're changing the whole text of the Supreme Court judgment. If you're changing the text of the Supreme Court judgment, it shall necessarily require a hearing. It is here that the wisdom of the judges will come into play to consider whether they have actually been misled or they have wrongly interpreted what the government says. If it is a case of being misled, the consequences are very serious, because you are playing with the Supreme Court. As a matter of fact, you're playing with the justice system. Forget the Supreme Court, you're playing with the justice system. If you're going to look upon its simplicity as a typographical mistake, the court will decide. In my opinion, this kind of a modification has very far-reaching implications, because you change the context of facts as understood by the court. Was, is, have different ramifications, has been, and had are totally different words. Tense leads to a lot of stress in this case, and it is going to lead to a lot of stress. I don't know how far the courts will go, but in normal circumstances, such applications are sort of tested with very serious alacrity.
Right.
It is for the court now to look at the position, but an application has been filed, a review has also been filed, whether the two will be heard together, or the court will only listen to the government's application, because reviews are heard in chambers, they're not heard openly. So the court decides to hear the application in open court. Everybody will have a chance to say what they have to, because that is where the justice system says that everybody has to be heard. So in my opinion, it's an application which should be considered, because it has ramifications for everybody. It should be considered in open court, and everybody should be heard on the matter. I mean, to treat it as an application simpliciter in the context of what has been stated in the judgment and what the government seeks to now contend becomes a matter of grave concern, because you are now saying that the Supreme Court has gone wrong by misreading what you have stated. And they say it is a misinterpretation of what they had said in the note. So therefore, it is now, I mean, I would, as a conservative lawyer, leave it to the wisdom of the court. But only, the only comment we can offer is, we are treading on very, very thin ground on the side of the government insofar as this is concerned, because this is what the government says, this is what the court understands.
Yes.
Saying anything more than that at this point of time would be that, look, let the court decide, because the application is there. Let the court consider it. They will hear it, or in the alternate, they will hear it with the reviews, or vice versa. They will hear.
There are two aspects, Mr. Vastava. You also said,
with this. So that is what is going to happen.
One, of course, we will have to leave it to the wisdom of the court to decide on whether or not they see this as them being misled intentionally, or this actually genuinely just being a very complicated submission that the government made, and somewhere so there was some kind of misunderstanding that the courts will have to take a view on. But the larger point, or another point rather, is also the fact that if the courts thought this deal is all right, they don't need to look into it, they don't need to go into the pricing details, they don't need to go into the executive territory, because the Comptroller and Auditor General has already looked into it and given a report, part of which has already been put into the public domain. All of it has been scrutinized by a public accounts committee. So there is enough scrutiny that has happened in the entire executive space, which is why the judiciary doesn't need to come in. Now, if that is what their reasoning was, then Geeta Luthra, does that reasoning now need a relook? Because all of that hasn't happened yet. We are still talking about CAG scrutinizing this.
One statement here.
Yes, Mr. Vasudev.
No, just one second here before you go to Geeta. You see, the fact is this. As per the government's own version, it has not gone to the PSC.
Yes.
As per the government's own version in the correction application, all that they say is that the CAG has been informed.
Yes.
So, therefore, what the Supreme Court has said,
that's right,
is totally contrary to what the government is saying now.
Absolutely.
It has not gone to the PSC. The CAG has only been informed. It has not looked into it. So, therefore, what is indirectly happening is that the Supreme Court observations, that it has been looked into by the CAG and has been sent to the PAC becomes very controversial.
Exactly. Exactly my point.
And it is here that the government is possibly stepping in to say, look, please don't misunderstand what we said. Yes.
Yes, exactly my point.
This is where the point is. The point is, which aspect, which part of it do you accept today?
Yes, yes. Geeta Luthra, your view on how you see this now being seen?
So the first thing I was wanting to comment on what Prashant said about the counter affidavit and whether it should be what the government says should be on affidavit. And I actually feel that somewhere the practice has to end that government files, you can file sensitive things or documents in sealed covers, but I feel it should be on affidavit. So this is one aspect which has long become a practice that state can file, say, a status report or an unsigned document. But the entire jurisprudence of writ jurisdiction was that they should say it on affidavit. So this is one aspect which has become a practice, but which practice I think should end. Not necessarily because it has gone wrong in this case, because it can go wrong in many cases. So this is one aspect as an overall perspective. The second part, which is the substratum of the Supreme Court judgment. So although the Supreme Court says we are not getting into the pricing and we are not looking at pricing, what a Supreme Court will look at is whether the correct procedures have been followed, and we substantially feel that the correct procedures have been followed.
So
pricing is not something we are looking at. But fortunately or unfortunately, it's gone into the fact, and the government affidavit has been misunderstood by it or has been understood in whatever context, and the government itself is saying it's misunderstood. So that's the best that they can go, that it was in fact saying this is the procedure, not this was the procedure which was followed, but the court understood that this was the procedure that was followed. So the court looks at it, says CAG has looked at it, PSC has looked at it, it's not in the court's domain. The court will only see if the right procedures have been followed. Now, one of the aspects in the review petition is we are not asking for the court to look at all this.
Yes.
We are asking, refer it to CBI.
Yes.
We are asking for an investigation. Now, that aspect also the court hasn't discussed. So I feel that in these circumstances, whether the union says that modify, we've been misunderstood, or the review says this is completely a wrong substratum. Fact is, I think it's something which requires reconsideration because it's an issue which is important, is hugely important, and therefore this sort of misunderstanding and this substratum of the Supreme Court's judgment, which is either due to a mistake or a misunderstanding, has happened, or whichever reason. Let's not go into the reasoning. Let's go into the fact that this is what has occurred. Then the court would perhaps in its wisdom think that let's just hear it out once in detail.
Absolutely.
But ultimately, it'll be for the court to look at this aspect, but it's something which definitely requires a very, very serious look.
Completely. And one often wonders what the reaction of Chief Justice Gogoi is going to be even if this hearing takes place and he's told that you misinterpreted what we gave to you in that sealed envelope. But we'll wait and watch how that hearing pans out. Aditya Shankar, you've heard what our legal experts have said.
Yeah, he may still have the same view. We don't know.
Yes, we don't know. But you heard, Aditya Shankar, what our legal experts are saying. And one point of contention is that what was given in the seal cover allegedly wasn't even signed, was like a simple note. We don't know who submitted it. Would you be able to shed some light on that? Is that how it's done? Who submitted it on behalf of the government?
Well, first and foremost, Tanvi, there are three points that need to be answered in the most important way.
Yes, Aditya, go ahead, please.
The first point is that this is a three-judge bench judgment led by the Chief Justice himself, who has scrutinized all the documents available on record, has come to a conclusive finding on three counts to decide a government tender when it comes to procuring fighter jets for the country. I'll mention it. What does the Supreme Court state? On page 8 of the judgment, the Supreme Court scrutinizes this matter on three points. Number one, illegality. Number two, irrationality. And number three, procedural impropriety. Now, we can go and tear this judgment into many shreds. I don't want to do that. Question here is that once the Supreme Court has come to a conclusive decision-making process that the entire purchase and procurement of Rafale jet was needed for the country, it was required for the country's security forces, it was required for protecting the sovereignty and integrity of India, it was a part of the entire process of selecting the fighter planes was done over a period of almost 10 years, including the years when the Congress party was in power, when the UPA had sanctioned this entire deal. 2012, the first contract of dissolution was with Reliance happened. That time it was Unified Reliance, with Mukesh Ambani and Anil Ambani both being in the lead. Then subsequently, they went their own ways. I don't want to go into that. Question here is that once issues of national security are to be given primacy, where they are supposed to be considered on issues of country sovereignty, integrity, and when the Supreme Court, the Honorable Chief Justice himself had summoned the requisite documents on a sealed cover. Himself. Now, whether they were signed or not is a matter of different interpretation, but the entire initiation came at the behest of the Supreme Court itself. That hereby, please give us the requisite documents, what is required to adjudicate this matter. And subsequently, let us decide that whether this entire deal was based on commercial favoritism or not. And what is the conclusion the Supreme Court has come about? The last conclusion is that there was no commercial favoritism. The right to choose an offset partner is the decision of the company. And that is what the government has been saying. Now, whether the entire review process that is going to be initiated by the other party is completely their jurisdiction, they want to come, maybe revoke a clause, maybe take whatever decision they want to, maybe file an application before the court, let the Chief Justice again decide himself that whether the judgment needs to be reviewed or not, that is a matter of interpretation of Supreme Court, and I would not like to comment on that. But given the fact that this judgment completely nails down this entire deal in every sense,
right,
and states that whatever has happened for the best, for the integrity and sovereignty of the country, I think that needs to be upheld.
Okay,
it is
so two aspects,
the Congress party is playing,
and I'm going to let Mohammad Khan rebut you on the second aspect, but yeah, you still haven't answered my question, Aditya Shankar. Was the whatever was given in the seal envelope to the Supreme Court an unsigned piece of document, and is that what usually the pattern or trend is? That today, if we have to find out whether somebody intentionally misled the Supreme Court or it was misinterpretation, who will be held responsible for that document?
Well, first of all, Tanvi, as far as answering your question is concerned, that is between the government and the Supreme Court. Now, let the government and the Supreme Court take a decision as to who is responsible, and let them file a review. Let the review be decided on merits. How are we supposed to decide in a television debate that whether the Supreme Court was given correct document or not?
No,
that the Supreme Court will examine on the legality.
Oh yes, absolutely. We can't decide whether the correct documents were given. I was just trying to understand whether we know who gave the documents or on whose behalf, because Prashant Bhushan raised this issue, and Tandi, I'm assuming this is something they will raise in court as well. I get your point, Aditya Shankar. Mohammad Khan, we hasn't spoken yet, so let's quickly go across to him, and then I will go to Kailash Vasudev on this point as well. But Mohammad Khan, first to you.
Well, it was interesting listening to Mr. Aditya Shankar, the new spokesperson for the BJP. Mr. Shankar is a very, very capable lawyer. But unfortunately, in this regard, all his skill aside, this is a losing brief. And I'll tell you why. Let's start with Mr. Jaitley's quote from today. Mr. Jaitley said, very smugly, I might add, that if it happens once, it is happenstance. If it happens twice, it's a mistake or an accident. If it happens thrice, there's a conspiracy. You've made three errors in this so-called sealed envelope. These three errors have been laid out beautifully by the three senior advocates on this panel. You've lied about the relationship with HAL, you've lied about the relationship with Ambani's, and you've lied about your typographical error CAG report. And you did not concede that until we came out, held a press conference and caught you on it. Because you read the judgment before us, as you claimed. You held a press conference before us, almost 2 hours before us. But both Jaitley Saab and Nirmala Sitaraman ji didn't point this out. If this was a typographical error, they should have immediately said, we'll get it corrected. Now, but they were too busy celebrating it at that point of time. Rafale is a scam, Aditya. It is a scam for three very simple reasons. You adopted an opaque process and you hid it in the garb of national security. I'll quote Bertrand Russell here, that I'll paraphrase what he said. In your case, national security is the last refuge of a scoundrel. You keep saying national security, but I don't think your leaders have any clue of what it means. Because in the past, we have had this mutual respect for each other that we share the details of defense deals with fellow members of parliament because we trust them as representatives of the people to be well informed enough to be part of the decision making process. History has numerous records of this, but you didn't choose to do that. Number two, you lied, you didn't, your leaders lied repeatedly, one after the other. When Francois Hollande, a former president, comes out and says you were compelled to take Anil Ambani's Reliance as a partner, of course we'll ask questions. I don't think Mr. Hollande wants to fight elections in India. I don't think he has a dog in the fight here. When you brought in Anil Ambani Reliance, a barely 15-day-old company, to replace an 80-year-old company,
so,
and said HAL could not deliver, that's why we brought in this company.
Mohammed, we've heard these arguments, not just today. We've heard these arguments.
A lot of times, so I'll just
conclude. I know, but
so I'll just conclude, Tanvi.
Okay, conclude this, but I'm just saying we've heard these arguments. One minute, Aditya Shankar, one minute. I'm just saying to the BJP representative and the Congress representative, these arguments have already been made repeatedly, Mohammed Khan. You also know it. We've heard Rahul Gandhi at least now make these arguments some three times.
So I'll conclude by saying this, na?
Yes.
I'll conclude by saying this. To Aditya ji and to the other panelists, Rahul ji has made the debate extremely simple. He has distilled it into 2 points. One, carry out a joint parliamentary inquiry, because every time in the past you have asked for it, every single time we have conceded because we've had the courage of our convictions and nothing to hide. Hamara daman saaf hai. And dusri baat, which Rahul ji has put forth today, debate him. He has challenged the Prime Minister. You have a 56-inch ki chhati and laal aankhe. It is about time that those were put to the test. That's all I have to say.
Okay, so I have a question for you very quickly. Congress says, and Rahul Gandhi keeps claiming, that this is a 1,30,000 crore scam. How did you arrive at that number, which was actually the question that Arun Jaitley asked? He didn't ask you about the 1,600 crore number. He asked you on the 1,30,000 crore number. How did you get that number?
So, I will explain. And this is a very good question. And the man who answered this the very first time in the public domain is a man by the name of Mr. Prashant Bhushan. Mr. Bhushan tweeted, and I'll tell you the date of the tweet so you can also cross-check it. Mr. Bhushan tweeted a page from Reliance Infrastructure Limited's annual report. Now, yes, here it is. 12th October 2018, Mr. Prashant Bhushan's timeline on Twitter. RIL annual statement clearly stated that the JV will discharge offset obligations worth 30,000 crores and the life cycle is all mentioned. He's taken a screenshot of their annual report, Tanvi, and he's put it out in the public domain where Reliance itself is conceding. BJP spokespersons are coming and holding a brief for Anil Ambani saying he's got only 800 crores when he himself is conceding 30,000 crores and life cycle contract. So please, these are all facts in the public domain. We are not manufacturing evidence like the BJP or relying on propaganda.
Okay, coming back to the legal discussion that we were just having, Mr. Kailash Vasudev, you had something to say to my question because Prashant Bhushan also raised, and Mr. Jeet Bhattacharya, I'll come to you next, but Kailash Vasudev first. Of course, the Attorney General may probably end up giving the envelope, but is it normal for it to be unsigned?
See, it's like this. They have given a note which the court asked them to give facts and figures of. The court didn't want the facts and figures in detail, said give us a note. So they have prepared a note on the best of information available to them and the Attorney General has filed it. The Attorney General holds a constitutional office. He represents the government and what he says is normally sacrosanct and accepted in good faith by the court. In many instances, as I said before, sealed covers have been given. Ligita also referred to the fact that sealed covers are given to court on the court asking for it. It's an accepted practice. Now, if the government has decided to disclose its facts to the court in a bona fide manner, without taking recourse to what is called the indemnity clause, they've chosen to expose themselves and tell the court what it has to do. The court has respected the decision because the court said, please give us the information. Today, to cast an aspersion saying that he didn't give it an affidavit, who signed it, the Attorney General said he will answer the questions to court. Mm. I mean, we are trying to make much out of everything because this is a very sensitive issue. And the worst part of it is, we are now trying to cast aspersions on a system which has been working very well in the past. Sealed cover proceedings, giving information in sealed covers, courts ask for it. We accept it as lawyers that this is what the government is giving. We will accept what the government is saying or what the other party is giving. I mean, Biswajit is here on the screen. He was an additional solicitor general. In his practice, he must have seen this happen. We've all seen it happen in courts.
Right.
So it is nothing which is extraordinary.
Absolutely.
What is extraordinary here is
Absolutely.
That maybe there is a misreading or a misrepresentation which the government says that's a different matter. But the fact is, sealed cover proceedings take place. They take place everywhere. They take place in government employment. They take place in government tenders. They take place in giving reports to the parliamentary committees. They take place in giving reports to the President of India. So everywhere the sealed cover is followed. It is not an exception. The question is, who presents it? The presentation here is by the Attorney General. Can you question the Attorney General's integrity in giving a report? I mean, I'm sorry to say it, but we're taking things a bit too far. Let the court examine it. We'll see who gave the report. If the court wants an inquiry, they will ask for an inquiry.
Okay.
But to turn around and make statements of this kind, I don't know. It's very sad that we are saying this.
Yes.
Government has given it. It's taking responsibility.
But
therefore, they're filing
a fresh
application saying that this is what we said in our note. They're not denying it.
But Mr. Vasudev, at the end of the day, we are also staring at a situation
yes.
where we are being told that three very, very wise, experienced judges, all three of them together, didn't understand what the government was telling them and had written to them in that note. So even that is an unprecedented situation, and perhaps then
True.
More questions need
True.
To be
That's
asked.
What the government...
Yes.
That is also unprecedented.
Exactly my point.
That's why, you see, you are now asking to set aside from is to be examined, has been given. You see, now these are factual statements which you may make in your report, but the court has read it in its own way depending on what arguments are addressed. So therefore, I asked you in the beginning, the court may decide to hear this application now or hear it with the reviews or vice versa.
Yes. Well, the government had filed it earlier.
It's a decision for the court to take.
Absolutely. No, absolutely. Biswajit Bhattacharya
right.
wanted to come in.
So
and then I want to go on to the aspect of what everybody thinks of this practice of sealed covers and submission of information in that aspect, because then it leads to confusion like this. Mr. Bhattacharya.
You see, I would like to make two simple points. First, this judgment, the ratio of the judgment is reflected from the last sentence of the last paragraph, where the Supreme Court makes it very clear that their views are based primarily on the touchstone of invoking jurisdiction of the Supreme Court under the Article 32 of the Constitution of India. Now, that is an overriding statement according to me. So, nothing has been decided by the Supreme Court on merit, in my view. I think this judgment has been much misunderstood.
Yes.
The Supreme Court has simply said, from the touchstone of exercising jurisdiction under Article 32, this is our view. So, therefore, jurisdiction of any other forum like Joint Parliamentary Committee or the Central Bureau of Investigation is not shut out, according to me. The second point I would like to tend to agree with my friend Kailash Vasudev, sealed cover or non-sealed cover, signed or unsigned, affidavit or no affidavit is not the issue.
Right.
The court in its own wisdom wanted to be assisted, and some documents have been placed before the court. The court has accepted that document. Now, who is the author is not of immediate importance now. The contents of the document is most important. If the context of the document, if the language of that document is misleading or ambiguous, bona fide or not bona fide, I'm not going into it. And if the court has understood, three very, very outstanding judges of our country have understanding in unison in one particular manner.
Yes.
Then to try and impute that, you know, I think that is very, very serious matter. I think the litigants, I won't say who's the litigant, obviously, the litigants are trading in very dangerous path. And it is wide open.
Right.
The entire country is watching as to what the...
Well, we're having a bit of a trouble with your feed, Mr. Bhattacharya, so I'm sorry I'll have to interrupt you there also because we are running out of time. So I'm going to thank all of our panelists for joining us this evening. I know I couldn't take too many answers from all of you, but when it comes to legal conversations, then it's difficult to interrupt, and answers are usually slightly more lengthy because you need to explain the legal aspect. But thank you for showing that amount of patience on this conversation. Sometimes it's good to have this kind of a constructive, in-depth analysis. We, of course, will wait and watch what happens in the Supreme Court. The government has filed an affidavit which says that, well, we gave you certain details, and on that details, perhaps you misinterpreted what you said. We were telling you this is the procedure. You assumed that this is what has been done. Up to you whether you want to modify the order. That's one aspect of it, and that's what the Supreme Court will take up at some point. The other aspect is, of course, these three big names and big faces, Prashant Bhushan, Arun Shori, and Yashwant Sinha, who've gone back to the Supreme Court and said, no, you need to, or our plea is, please review your order. You didn't even consider our original plea. We are demanding a CBI investigation into this. Now, the government says that the Supreme Court has already given its verdict and given a clean chit to the Rafale, whereas many others say that what the Supreme Court has done has said that we are satisfied that we don't need to step into the territory of the government. The procedure seems to have been followed, and so we don't need to interfere. But if the procedure so far hasn't been followed and is still in process, if the CAG report isn't done and given to the Public Accounts Committee, if enough amount of scrutiny hasn't happened of the deal, then can we really assume that the procedure was followed? That's perhaps what the Chief Justice and the other judges of the Supreme Court will have to consider. Will there be a review of that petition? That's the big question. Of course, the politics will continue on the other side, and we'll keep seeing more fireworks in the parliament. Stay tuned for more on this big deal to Mirror Now. Thank you so much for joining us on this debate.